moment. Just wanted to give you a quick explanation. Again, I'm sure some of you heard this a moment ago, but there's probably one or two new people. So the way this will work best is we would like everybody who's comfortable remaining unmuted with their camera on, so long as they can be quiet. It is important that you understand that on Zoom, any noise you make will be heard by all. So if in the middle of a song, if your phone rings or you're talking to somebody in the room, everybody will hear it just as loud as the performance. But as long as you're in a quiet space, we shouldn't have any problems. I will be here to mute anybody if necessary. But Howie does have some trivia questions and some live discussions. So the more people that are engaged, the more fun we'll all have. And with that, I will pass this along to Ona from the Beverly Library.
Hi, everyone. This is Ona from the Beverly Public Library. It's nice to see some of you. I see some familiar faces. Well, this is a different version of Monday mornings than we're all used to, but I'm glad we got to continue this in a different form. I just want to thank the friends. They are continuing to fund the Monday mornings program. So big thank you to the Friends of the Beverly Public Library. And as you can tell by this great slide that Howie has provided us, we are here for the musical baseball show this morning. And now I will turn it back over to Howie and Brandon. Thank you.
Okay. Well, good morning, everybody. Actually, I'm going to change my screens to the gallery view so I can see everybody. So just hold on for 1 second. Okay, so yeah, my name is Howie Newman. Let me explain to you what you signed up for here. It's a musical baseball show, so I'm going to be doing some baseball songs, most of which I've written, but there will be a few songs that you know, and doing some trivia, telling some stories, and as Brandon explained, we're trying to make this as interactive as possible, so feel free to join in if you have a question or a comment or a good recipe or whatever, you know, just feel free to interrupt, preferably not in the middle of a song because that can be a little bit distracting. But we've had good success with this. We've had a lot of fun with it. And so I hope, I assume we will have the same this morning. And also we're going to have a free raffle for one of my baseball albums. I'll explain how that works a little bit later on. But anyway, so that's also another way we need to be interactive. Anyway, before I get started here, I want to just kind of get a pulse of the audience. How many of you guys are like diehard baseball fans? All right, one, okay. So I expect you're going to do well on the trivia questions. And how many of you are just kind of casual fans? Okay, and how many of you, you're just sick of Netflix, you want to try something different, it's free, you figure what the heck, you know, all right, good. Anyway, let me explain a little bit about my background. I was a sports writer for 18 years. I covered the Red Sox quite a bit. I worked for the Patriot Ledger, the Lowell Sun, the Boston Globe, the Lynn Daily Item, Associated Press, baseball magazines, et cetera, et cetera. And I covered the World Series in 1985 and 1986. And in 1985, did not have a laptop. You know, I don't think anybody had laptops. There were portable computers, but there were no laptops. They were these big, bulky things. So in order to file the story, I had to go to the Associated Press office in the city where the game was. In that year, it was Kansas City and St. Louis. And but the following year, I covered the World Series between the Mets and the Red Sox. And got one of these, which is the Radio Shack TRS-80. It was revolutionary, it was cutting edge, it was amazing. You could actually type your story on this computer, hook it up to a phone line, and send it into the home office. It was great, it saved a lot of time and effort and running around. And it had 21,000 bytes of memory. So you could get about 5 stories on here, and then you had to start erasing stuff. And just to compare this to your average smartphone, this has 0.0008% of the memory of a smartphone, but it was great back then, I'll tell you.
Right.
And in addition to writing, I actually did the Lowell Spinners Radio. The Lowell Spinners are a half-season single A team in Lowell, Mass. and I was the color commentator for that. And it's not that easy because you don't get all this piles and piles of information from the PR department. You know, you have to kind of wing it. And it would not be unusual for a player to come into the game and we didn't know who he was because he just got there that day, and the players, they come and they go. And so I'd have to scurry from the radio booth over to the press box and find someone who knew who this guy was. But it was a lot of fun doing that. And I actually got to do play-by-play a couple of times, which is every boy's dream, or every person's dream, really. The first time, the regular play-by-play guy was late getting back from a bathroom break, you know? So it totally caught me by surprise. You know, you have the headphones on and you hear the commercials and then the music comes on, you know that you're going on the air live. And I did it okay. And in addition to that, I've been a baseball fan ever since I was 10 years old, which is a long time. And I've been to 94 major and minor league ballparks, which is not that easy because my wife doesn't like baseball, so I have to kind of work around that. And I had a trip scheduled in June to go to the three. There are only three ballparks now in existence that I haven't been to, and I had a trip planned to go to Texas, Miami, and Atlanta, but not adding to my total this year, and nobody's adding to their total this year, actually. And I've got a couple of CDs of baseball songs. There's Baseball's Greatest Hits Volume 1 and Baseball's Hits Volume 2. We're going to raffle off. This is my most recent one. We're going to raffle that off later on. And they're both in the Hall of Fame archive in Cooperstown, New York, which is where they keep music and written material and stuff. So I'm pretty excited about that. I'm going to start off with a song about Johnny Damon. You remember Johnny Damon? How could you forget Johnny Damon? He was quite instrumental in the Red Sox winning the World Series in 2004. He was a multi-tool player. He could hit, he could run, he could field, he could hit with power. He couldn't throw worth a damn, but, you know, can't have everything. And had a lot of big hits for the Red Sox that postseason. He had a grand slam against the Yankees in the seventh game of the League Championship Series that broke that game open and initiated that amazing comeback from three games down to none. And had some big hits in the World Series as well. The following season, 2005, he batted .316, his all-time career high. And he became a free agent over the winter. And he did the unthinkable, which was to sign a contract with the New York Yankees for a mere $12 million more. I mean, the nerve of that guy. So I wrote a song about it, and people thought it was kind of amusing, you know, back then. And after a few years, it got a little dated, so I stopped playing it. But now it's retro, it's nostalgic, making a comeback. Why did you go? Why did you go? Johnny Damon, why did you take the cash and run? Do you think in New York City you'll be having this much fun? They cut your hair and shave your beard and you smile. Just say thanks. We don't love you anymore, 'cause now you're with the Yanks. Perhaps they didn't tell you, perhaps you did not know. Left center field, 450 plus, are you gonna make that throw? There's lots more ground to cover, you're getting slower every year. And I bet by mid-July you wish that you were here. Why did you go, Johnny Damon? Why did you take the cash and run? Do you think in New York City you'll be having this much fun? They cut your hair and shave your beard. You smile, just say thanks. We don't love you anymore, 'cause now you're George, you don't like me, though you best be on your guard. 'Cause if you don't hit 300, life will never be so hard. And if you don't make the playoffs and win a couple rounds, the fans will cuss and swear at you, run you out of town. Why did you go, Johnny Damon? Why did you take the cash and run? Do you think in New York City you'll be having this much fun? Cut your hair and shave your beard, you smile. don't love you anymore, now you're with the Yanks. Johnny Damon, why did you take the cash and run? Do you think in New York City you will be having this much fun? You're out of sight and out of mind, don't think that you'll be missed. We don't need you anymore, 'cause we got Cocoa Crisp. Okay, thank you. You're allowed to clap. If you're allowed to clap, thank you. All right, we're trying to make this like a concert, you know. So feel free to take your unmute yourself, because actually we're gonna do our first trivia question in a minute. But I just wanted to mention that Cocoa Crisp, of course, was the guy who replaced Johnny Damon in center field, but the Red Sox, they had this long range plan. They had a hot shot in the minor leagues named Jacoby Ellsbury. He became the center fielder. Before too long, and then, so I rewrote the last chorus to reflect that bit of information, and then Ellsbury signed with the Yankees too, so I said, heck with it, you know. So. All right, we're gonna do our first trivia question. This is my favorite one, because it harkens back to a different era, and only two people have gotten it, and I've done about 60 of these shows over the past few years. And one of them was a ringer. He was a sports writer, you know, so. That doesn't count. All right, so what pitcher holds the record for the most strikeouts in one game? You want to take a guess? Excuse me?
No, I don't know.
You don't know. Anybody want to take a guess? Who are the great strikeout pitchers of all time? Okay, well, a lot of people would say Roger Clemens, Kerry Wood, Max Scherzer, Randy Johnson. And if you answered those, if you came up with those answers, you would be wrong. Because those guys hold the record for strikeouts in a 9-inning game. Each of them struck out 20 batters in a 9-inning game. As a matter of fact, Roger Clemens from the Red Sox did it twice. Only pitcher ever to do it twice. But that's not the right answer, because I didn't say 9-inning game. I said a game. And back in the old days, they used to pitch the whole game. So in 1962, Tom Chaney of the Washington Senators struck out 21 batters in a 16-inning game against the Baltimore Orioles, which he won 2-1. He pitched the entire game, and so he holds the record. And it's interesting, because a lot of the hallowed baseball records are held by players who are not outstanding all-star players. Tom Chaney only won 19 games his entire career. He was 19-29. But on that particular day, he had it going. Okay, so I'm going to do, so you probably never heard of Tom Chaney. This is a song about another player you probably never heard of, but this is going to be very educational. You're going to walk away from this show with a lot of knowledge that's fairly useless, but interesting. This is about a ball player named Mike Hessman, and probably never heard of him. But he has a fascinating story. He holds the record for the most home runs hit in the minor leagues, which is kind of a dubious record. It's kind of a double-edged sword, because he played 20 years of professional baseball, almost all of it in the minor leagues, hit 433 home runs in the minor leagues. But on the other hand, he probably didn't figure that was the way, or didn't hope that was the way his career was going to go. But anyway. He was kind of a baseball nomad. He played for 16 different teams over 20 years. Wow. And there were three seasons in which he played for four different teams. So he would get signed, he'd get released, he'd sign again. He had a lot of power. He struck out a lot and hit for a low average, but he had a lot of power, and that was attractive to a lot of people. And so I wrote a song about it. I sent him a copy of the song, and I kind of heard third hand that he liked it, because it was written up in one of the local papers where he was coaching. But I finally caught up with him a couple of years ago. Yeah, he retired after the 2015 season, and became a hitting coach in the minor leagues. And in 2018, he was working for the Erie Sea Wolves of the Eastern League. And they had a doubleheader one day up in Portland, Maine. So I drove up there and I got to meet him. We took a photo together. And you can see he's a pretty big dude because I'm about 5'10". So he's like 6'5 or so and 225 pounds. He's a big, strong guy. And he was very cordial, very friendly. We had a nice chat. And he has no regrets about his baseball career. He enjoyed every minute of it, and now he's enjoying coaching. And so I wrote the song about his career and his life. And it goes like, it's called The Ballad of Mike Hessman. And it goes like this. If you mention Mike Hessman, that name might not ring a bell. A legend in his own right with a grand story to tell. He hit more home runs than any minor leaguer ever did. It took dedication, heart and soul, and a ton of grit. He just kept playing cause he loved it, living out of greed, playing baseball for a living ever since he was 18. Years flew by just like the wind. He never lost that thirst. Becoming minor league home run king is a blessing and a curse. It started out in Macon. Young Mike just had no fear. 1997, he hit 21 that year. Danville, Greenville, and Myrtle Beach along the way. The homers kept coming on the road to Triple A. Just kept playing cause he loved it, living out his dream, playing baseball for the living ever since he was 18. Years flew by just like the wind, he never lost that thirst. Becoming minor league home run king was a blessing and a curse. The year that Mike turned 30, he was still in Triple A. 31 and 32, the time just slipped away. He played in Mexico and Japan, Venezuela too. 16 teams in 20 years, till finally he was through. Majors, the answer is yes. He had cups of coffee with the Braves, the Tigers, and the Mets. 14 big league homers, 5 seasons in the show. With a bit of luck, might have stuck. I guess we'll never know. He just kept playing cause he loved it. Living out his dream, playing baseball for a living. 18 years flew by just like the wind. He never lost that thirst. Becoming minor league home run king was a blessing and a curse. Hey, so that is the thank you. That is the story of Mike Hessman, a minor league home run king. All right, I'm going to get unraveled here, get untangled, and tell you a little bit about a project that I did in 1985, which is 35 years ago. I don't need the guitar for this, so I'm gonna. So I did a nationwide campaign to get rid of the designated hitter rule. Now, I know that sounds like heresy here in Boston, because David Ortiz was a designated hitter, and you know, he helped them win 3 World Series and was very popular and a great player. But I just never liked it. But before we get going here, I want to just see, and those of you who just entered the room, if you can put on your video and unmute yourself, that would kind of make this more like a community concert. But if you're not comfortable, that's fine. There we go. okay, so I just want to get an idea of how many of you guys like the designated hitter rule. And how many of you guys don't like it? And how many of you have no idea what I'm talking about? All right, well, I'll explain what it is. So the designated hitter rule, or the DH rule, was instituted by the American League in 1973. And prior to that, the years running up to 1973, offense in baseball was spiraling downward at kind of an alarming rate. Less hits, less home runs, less runs, and the owners were getting increasingly fearful. So what they did was they tried this rule out on an experimental basis and eventually adopted it full time, whereby the pitcher didn't have to bat, because pitchers typically are not great hitters. So the pitcher wouldn't bat, and there would be someone in the lineup called the designated hitter who would bat instead of the pitcher. So essentially, you had two players sharing one position. You had the pitcher who would pitch but not be in the lineup, and then the designated hitter who would not play the field, who would just hit. So I never liked it. I guess I'm an old timer. I'm a traditionalist, a purist, you know. But it changes a lot of the fundamental strategies and nuances of the game. For instance, if you want to make a pitching change and you're managing without the DH, you have to see, well, where's the pitcher coming up in the lineup? Will I have to pinch hit for him down the line? If I do, who am I going to use to pinch hit? Who am I going to bring in next? But with the DH, you don't have to do that. And if you have a player who's a great hitter but doesn't really have a position, then you have to figure out, there's another strategy. You have to figure out, well, where am I going to play this guy where he's going to hurt me the least? So those are couple of things that go out the window when you have the DH. And I actually like watching the pitchers hit, because even though they don't do well most of the time, when they do something amazing, it's just an unexpected source of excitement. And for instance, I went to a game between the Mets and the Cubs where Rick Sutcliffe, pitching for the Cubs, got two hits in one inning. That's pretty amazing. And I don't know if you remember back to the 70s, but Rick Wise was a guy who used to pitch for the Red Sox. He accomplished this feat while he was with the Phillies. He probably had the most amazing game of any player in Major League history. Rick Wise pitched a no-hitter in 1971. He pitched a no-hitter and hit two home runs in the same game. I mean, that's just phenomenal. And Jim Tobin, who was a pitcher for the Boston Braves, hit three home runs in one game, only pitcher ever to do that. And Tony Cloninger, pitching for the Braves, hit two grand slams in one game and an RBI single. He had nine RBIs. Those are still, the two Grand Slams and the nine RBIs are still the records, team records for the Braves. And he was the first National League player to do that, to hit two Grand Slams in a game. It's only been done, I think, 13 times in Major League history. And Earl Wilson, if you remember back the Red Sox in the 60s, excuse me, hit 35 career home runs. He played for the Red Sox and the Tigers and a bunch of other teams. 35 career home runs, and two of them as a pinch hitter, because he was a big, strong guy, and when he got hold of one, he could send it a long way. And finally, consider this. Babe Ruth, Bill Terry, George Sisler, Ted Williams, and Stan Musial all began their careers as pitchers. So if they had the designated hitter rule back in the early 1900s, Babe Ruth would have never become a hitter. He never would have hit 714 home runs, saved baseball, and the entire evolution of the universe would have been changed, and I probably wouldn't be standing here today. So, anyway, fast forward to like 1985, Peter Ueberroth, the commissioner of baseball, decided, well, I'm going to take a poll of all the baseball fans and see if we want to keep the designated hitter rule or get rid of it. So I decided I'm going to do this national campaign. I was a lot younger. I didn't have kids then, and you know, I had a lot more energy. So if you want to do a national campaign, you got to come up with a catchy slogan. So this was my slogan here, dump the DH. And I printed up a couple of thousand bumper stickers, and I made up a brochure of some of the facts that I just talked about and some other things. And I sent it all over radio and TV and newspapers and magazines. And it was the 1985 version of going viral. I mean, it was amazing. It was written up in the New York Times, the Los Angeles Herald. It was on TBS, national cable. And I did 30 radio shows, including one night I did 3 hours in San Francisco. People just wanted to talk about this. They're very passionate about it. And I also got a story to run in Sports Illustrated. They actually came out to my house and took a photo and interviewed me. And when that that ran in Sports Illustrated, it went out to about 4 million people. And from that point forward, I started getting mail from all over the world. People were, because I was selling the Dump the DH bumper sticker and a brochure for a couple of bucks. So I started getting, people were sending me cash from New Zealand and Mexico and Europe. It was pretty amazing. So you're probably wondering, well, what happened with the poll? How did that turn out? Well, the poll never took place. And I actually know that, I did some research on it, but I actually got to talk to Peter Ueberroth because he was a guest on Larry King's show, and I was able to call in and find out. So, and I asked him directly, and he hemmed and hawed and really didn't give us any information. So you're probably thinking, well, you know, the whole campaign, all that money and all that effort went for naught. But I had a lot of fun with it, and I got into the Hall of Fame because my bumper sticker is now in the Hall of Fame Museum. Can we get that up there? Yeah. In the main museum, it's got my name underneath it. So pretty cool. So had a lot of fun, got into the Hall of Fame. Can't really complain about that. All right, we're going to do another trivia question. But before we do that, I want to tell you about the CD raffle. So we're going to raffle off one of my baseball CDs for free. We're going to do this virtually, and if you win, you'll get a digital copy of the album emailed to you. So what you have to do is go into the chat room. Do you know where the chat room is? It's probably at the bottom center of your screen, and put your name and a number between 0 and 100. And I gave Brandon a number before the – you remember what it is, Brandon?
Yep, got it.
You got it. Okay, so put a number between 0 and 100 next to your name, and then the person closest to it will receive a copy of the CD. And if you want to buy the CD, you can go on my website and do that as well. But all right, so here's the trivia question. Got to tune up first, though. The Red Sox pulled off a big blockbuster trade in 2004. They traded Nomar Garciaparra to the Chicago Cubs. So which two players did they receive in return? Can I remember? I know it was a while ago, but I'll give you a couple more seconds. Okay, well, it was a very complicated trade. It involved four teams. It involved the Red Sox, the Montreal Expos, the Cubs, and the Minnesota Twins. And they received Orlando Cabrera from the Montreal Expos, who became their shortstop and did very well, helped them win the World Series. And also Doug Minkiewicz from the Minnesota Twins. And Doug Minkiewicz actually recorded the final out of the 2004 World Series. There he is, jumping up in the air, and Keith Foulke. If you remember, it was a ground ball back to Foulke, and he flipped it over to Minkiewicz. So I wrote a song about Doug Minkiewicz, but that's not why I wrote the song. I wrote the song because until he came to the Red Sox, I could never pronounce his name, you know? It's one of these long names, and they had to take the vowels out to squeeze it into the box score. So, but when once he came over here, and it's on radio, it's on TV, it's in the newspaper. I learned how to say it, and I found this name to be a very poetic name. It had sort of a poetic cadence to it. Kind of fun to say, Doug Minkiewicz, you know? And I figured if it was that much fun to say, it must be 3, 4, 5 times as much fun to sing. So that's why I wrote the song. Doug Minkiewicz, he's my favorite player. Doug Minkiewicz, he's the man, he's the man. Doug Minkiewicz, I just love to say it. Doug Minkiewicz, he's the man, he's the man. When he was a twin, it didn't mean a thing. Then he joined the Sox. Doug Minkiewicz really rocked. Doug Minkiewicz, he's my favorite player. Doug Minkiewicz, he's the man, he's the man. He's kind to his mother and a former gold glover. Doug may not make the Hall of Fame, but he's got 12 letters in his name. Doug Minkiewicz, I can't even spell it. Doug Minkiewicz, but I sure do like to yell it. Doug Minkiewicz, he's my favorite player. Doug Minkiewicz, he's the man, he's the man. M-I-E-N-T-K-I-E-W-I-C-Z. I think that's right. Doug Minkiewicz, he's my favorite player. Doug Minkiewicz, he just took that ball and ran. Doug Minkiewicz, I just love to say it. Doug Minkiewicz, he's the man, he's the man. He's the man, he's the man. Doug Minkiewicz, he's the man. Alrighty, thank you very much. Thank you. That's actually not too much, didn't learn too much about him in that song, but that's okay. Learned how to spell it. Okay, so I told you about the Dump the DH campaign. Well, that was 1985. I did that, and I decided the next year I was going to do another campaign, because now I know how to do this stuff, so it's going to be even bigger and better. So I decided in 1986 to do a national campaign to get rid of artificial turf, because it was very prevalent in the 80s. And, you know, I don't think anybody really liked it. I mean, the ball shot through the infield like it was coming out of a cannon. It took weird bounces in the outfield. It was hard on the player's legs, and it was ugly looking, too. So, as I said, you got to come up with that catchy slogan. So here it is. Pull out the rug. Printed up a couple thousand of these things and put together this brochure. I did a lot of research on this. I talked to agronomists and turf experts. And scientists, and you know, it got written up in USA Today and a few other papers, but for some reason, it did not have nearly the effect of the Dump the DH campaign. So I don't know why, but so anyway, I've got like a couple of hundred of these bumper stickers left over. So if you want one, let me know. I'll figure out a way to get it to you. But perhaps you're wondering how artificial turf came into existence. I mean, did somebody just wake up one day and say, well, plastic grass has got to be better than real grass? Maybe you're wondering it. Or maybe you don't really care, but you're going to hear about it anyway, so I'm going to tell it to you. So the way artificial turf came into existence was in 1962, the National League expanded, added two new teams, the New York Mets and the Houston Colt 45s. They had to change their name to the Astros because of a trademark infringement. And anybody been to Houston? Any of you guys ever been to Houston? What's it like in Houston?
Hot.
It's hot. I think you're muted, so you need to unmute yourself there. But I assume you said it was hot.
Urban sprawl.
Yeah. It's big sprawling, but it's really hot. It's uncomfortable. So they played all their games at night. They played Saturday night, Sunday night, holiday nights. It was actually unthinkable back in the 60s to play a game on a Sunday night, but they did. But they had a long-range plan in mind, and they were going to build this new stadium. It had a dome on it. They were going to air condition the stadium. It was going to be great. No rainouts, comfortable temperatures, low humidity. And so in 1965, they opened the Houston Astrodome, and it was heralded as the eighth wonder of the world. And there it is. They did have some problems with it initially, though. As you can see, the roof is made of these translucent panels, and the original version of that created a background that was very difficult for fielders to track the ball. So infield pop-ups were dropping all over the place. Routine fly balls were turning into doubles and triples, and So they had to figure out, they couldn't play a whole season like that, so they had to figure out something. So they actually, they painted the panels to provide a better background, and that solved the problem. The fielders had no problem seeing the ball. The only problem was no sunlight came in and all the grass died. So by the end of the year, they had these big blotches of brown all over the field. It was ugly. They were spray painting it green. They were throwing dirt out there and they were painting that. And they figured they had to come up with a solution to this for the next season. So over the winter, they partnered with Monsanto and came up with artificial turf. So that's how artificial turf came into existence. And there are four fields. Here's another trivia question. There are four fields in Major League Baseball that still have the artificial turf. Can anybody name any of those four?
No, Bob.
What was that? I'm sorry. I have to be like 6 feet away from the computer, so it's hard for me to hear it sometimes. What was your guess? Toronto is one, Roger Center in Toronto. And then Tropicana Field in Tampa, where the Tampa Bay Rays play, that was another one. And actually, I went to that ballpark several years ago, and it's generally considered to be the worst ballpark in Major League history, but I had such low expectations that I actually enjoyed it. The other two are in the National League. No, actually, one more in the American League, which is the new Texas Stadium, where the Rangers are playing. That has artificial turf. And then Chase Field in Phoenix, Arizona, originally had natural turf, and it had a retractable dome, so you could get the sunlight in. But it's very hot in Arizona as well, and they used so much water to maintain that field, they thought it was environmentally irresponsible to keep the grass, so they switched it out, I believe it was last year. So anyway, about 7 or 8 years prior to this campaign, I had written a song about artificial turf because it was the 70s and all the folk singers, you know, they were writing protest songs. So this was my protest song. And I actually incorporated this song into the campaign. And actually, you know, it may have had a latent effect, even though it wasn't overly successful. Because, like I said, only four fields have artificial turf now, so. So here it is. Now we got artificial flavors and artificial snow. Imitation mayonnaise, false teeth, and you know you got artificial colors in your food and for your hair. But that artificial grass is just too much for me to bear. If Abner Doubleday was alive, he'd be aghast. If he went to a baseball game and didn't see no grass, just a big green carpet with some fancy white lines, a little bit of dirt, and those metric signs, he'd see AstroTurf. AstroTurf, what have they done to old Mother Earth? I don't want nothing eat my feet that a horse can't eat. So take it away. It all began in Houston where they play the game indoors. They built the big dome stadium. One of its flaws was the grass just wouldn't grow where the sun refused to shine, so they ripped it out and put in the artificial kind. They put in AstroTurf. AstroTurf, what have they done to old Mother Earth? I don't want nothing in my feet that a horse can eat, so take it away. Okay, thank you. All righty. That's more than you need to know about artificial turf, but you got it. We're going to do another trivia question. This is a fairly simple one, so unmute yourself. Otherwise, I won't be able to hear your answers. But how many 200-hit seasons did Ted Williams have? I want to take a guess. He played 19 years, so it's between 0 and 19, I guess. Anybody want to take a stab?
10.
10? That's way off. But
4.
Four is closer. You would think that Ted Williams, who was one of the greatest hitters of all time, would have had a lot of 200-hit seasons. But the correct answer is 0. He never had 200 hits in a season. And there were a couple of reasons for that. First of all, he played in the era of the 154-game schedule, so that was 8 less games that he had. But more importantly, his philosophy of hitting was that he had a very, very disciplined strategy to hitting. And he did not swing at a ball that was outside the strike zone. So he drew more walks than all but 2 players in Major League history. He was third on the all-time list, and he probably would have been first had he not been in the military for 5 years. So he drew a lot of walks. So he, you know, those were potential times when he could have gotten a hit. So he had 190 hits or more twice, and even the year that he batted 406, which he was the last player to bat 400, in 1941, he only had 185 hits, but he had 147 walks. And his on-base percentage was .482 for his career, which means that about every other time he came to the plate, he reached base on a hit or a walk, which is pretty unbelievable, really. So that's another little kind of tricky trivia question. I also should point out that the baseball songs are about 10% of the songs that I've written. So I've written a lot of other kind of quirky, funny, and some serious songs too. So if you go to my website, you can check that out. But a lot of people get the wrong impression that all I do is baseball songs, but not true. But I do songs about everyday life. And for me, part of my everyday life is following baseball. So I've done that. Anyway, this is a song about a sort of a semi-tragic event that happened in 1978 to the Red Sox. Does anybody remember what happened to the Red Sox in 1978? Okay, well, I will tell you. So the Red Sox had a 14-game lead on the Yankees for the division, to win the Eastern Division, and they squandered it away and wound up tied at the end of the regular season. And they had to do a one-game tiebreaker with the Yankees, and they were looking pretty good in that one game. So the winner went to the playoffs, and they were ahead 2-0 in the 7th inning, and Mike Therese was throwing a shutout, and then Bucky Dent came up and hit a home run. I think we have a picture of Bucky, don't we? Yeah, there he is. He had a 3-run home run into the net in left field. And that put the Yankees ahead to stay, and they won the game. They won the division. No wild card back then, so the Red Sox won 99 games and went home. And actually, if you could see in the background, you could see actual people sitting in the seats at Fenway Park, which is kind of a interesting thing. There you go. See? There are actual people there. No cutouts. So anyway, I wrote a song about that season, and it was also inspired by my mother, who was a Brooklyn Dodgers fan. And, you know, the Dodgers had great teams in the 40s and 50s, but they could never beat the Yankees in the World Series, although they did one time, 1955. But every other time they lost. So the battle cry out of Brooklyn every year was wait until next year. And that's the title of this song. This was the best damn team that I ever did see. It had strength up the middle, it had power and speed. Most of the season they could do no wrong, but when October rolled around, it was the same old song. Wait until next year. Wait until next year. Exactly what went wrong is all too clear. So near and so far. Close but no cigar. It's a long, long way till opening day, and the winter's getting near. Have another beer, wait till next year. We all thought it was a piece of cake, that 12-game lead at the All-Star break, but the pitching's long. lousy. The hitting got worse, and the next thing I knew, we were out of first. Wait until next year. Wait till next year. It's a long, long wait till opening day, and the winter's getting near. Have another beer. Wait till next year. Well, the clouds of the summer became the outs of the fall. That baseball team made fools of us all. Squandered that lead and it didn't take long. And October arrived with the same old song. Wait until next year. Wait till next year. Exactly what went wrong is all too clear. So near and so far. Close but no cigar. It's a long, long way till opening day, and the winter's getting near. Have another beer. Wait till next year. Have another beer. Wait till next year. Okay, thank you very much. One of the things that I love about baseball is that it has like the best jargon, the best expressions, the best nicknames. So this next song is a bit of baseball jargon. It's called Mendoza Line, and it's on my Baseball's Greatest Hits Volume 2 CD. Anybody know what the Mendoza Line is? Nope? Okay, well, see, it's going to be very informative as well as entertaining. So the Mendoza line stands for a 200 batting average, and so you're either above it or below it. And like J.D. Martinez has been flirting with it the last month or so. And I was inspired by Mario Mendoza, who is the prototypical slick-fielding, weak-hitting shortstop. He managed to stay in the major leagues for 9 seasons based solely on his defensive ability. There he is. He played for 3 teams. He played for the Pirates, as shown there, played for the Mariners, and he played for the Texas Rangers, and they stayed in the major leagues for 9 seasons. And he became infamous one day when George Brett, I'm sure you've heard of George Brett, Hall of Famer, third baseman, he had started this season in a terrible slump, and he was talking to reporters one afternoon, and he said something to the effect of, "I knew I was off to a slow start when I looked at the averages and saw that I was below the Mendoza line." So from that point forward, Mario Mendoza became this sort of tragic icon, always associated with a 200 batting average. So I thought it'd be kind of fun to write a song about it. So, you know, I went on the internet, did a little research, came up with this song. And when it was finished, I liked it enough to go and record it. So before you record a song, you got to figure out, well, what kind of song is this going to be? You know, like what musical genre? You can't just be like Bruce Springsteen and go into the studio and start experimenting with all these different arrangements. So to my ear, Mendoza Line sounds like something from the Wild Wild West. So we did like a country and western version, put together this great, great country band in the studio and recorded it. It came out really well. And I was thinking, you know, it'd be really fun to have the guys from the band come in and sing it with me and play it with me, but that's, of course, not practical. So I've got the next best thing for you, which is the karaoke version of the song. It'll sound just like the band is here. And so I'd like to do that for you right now, and there's a little sing-along part in it for you. Now, I know a lot of people say, well, you can't do sing-alongs on Zoom because there's a 2-second delay, but we do it anyway. So I need a couple of seconds here to crank this up. I'm mired in this awful slump. I need some luck to clear the hump, or I'll be riding buses any day. I need a hit so bad that I could cry. The worse I do, the harder I try. That 90 feet looks like a mile away. I'll take a blooper flare, a 16 hopper, a lucky bouncer, a Baltimore chopper. Just get me cross, that old man knows a lie. Of course, I'd prefer a frozen rope, but a swinging bunt would give me hope. I gotta cross that old Mendoza line. Here's the sing-along. Mendoza line, Mendoza line. Just get me cross that old Mendoza line. Mendoza line, Mendoza line. Gotta cross that old Mendoza line. Now Mario Mendoza, for whom this line is named, was an actual big leaguer for 686 games. He played short and second, a little third, at quite a glove, so I've heard, which was essential, cause he barely hit his way. Though known for his infield utility, he set the benchmark for futility, flirting with 200 all the time. Now in 79, tied an all-time mark for the most games played in a big league park with an average below the Mendoza line. I'll take a blooper flare, a 16 hopper, a lucky bouncer, a Baltimore chopper. Just get me cross that old Mendoza line. Of course, I'd prefer a frozen rope, but a swinging bunt would give me hope. I gotta cross that old Mendoza line. Let me hear you now. Mendoza line. Just get me across that old Mendoza line. Mendoza line. Mendoza line. Gotta cross that old Mendoza line. And this is the only song where I can take a drink in the middle, so I'm going for it. Playoffs only once, and here's his stats. 3 games played and 1 hit in 5 total at-bats. Do the math correctly, you will surely find. It's right smack dab on that Mendoza line. So if you're struggling on the field or any part of life, think of that brave soul from south of the border. He plugged and scrapped his whole life through, only to be linked to ineptitude. He's a true immortal of a different order. I'll take a blooper flare, a 16 hopper, a lucky bouncer, a Baltimore chopper. Just get me across that old Mendoza line. Of course, I'd prefer a frozen rope, but a swinging bunt. Give me hope, I gotta cross that old Mendoza line. Last time. Mendoza line, Mendoza line. Just get me cross that old Mendoza line. Cross that old Mendoza line, Mendoza line. Gotta cross that old Mendoza line. Just get me cross that old Mendoza line. Get me cross that old Mendoza line. All right. Thank you very much. Let me introduce the members of the band. Directly behind me on the drums is Chris Anzalone. Play along, please. Thank you. Thank you. A little applause for you. On my left here on bass, Rob Ignazio. To my right, on electric guitar and mandolin, Steve Mayone. And on backup vocals, actually, I did all the backup vocals. And there's a reason for that, you know? Thank you very much. Thank you. There's a reason for that, because, you know, you go into a studio and you hire professional singers, it gets pretty expensive pretty quickly. So I did all the vocals myself, and I only charged myself half as much. So I saved quite a bit of money doing that. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're saying to yourself right now, this is just some cheap publicity stunt to promote the CD. Well, let me tell you something. You're right, you got me. So it's called Baseball's Greatest Hits, Volume 2. And you can order it off my website, or you can order it off iTunes, or CD Baby, or Amazon or any of those places. All right. You know, a lot of people think that baseball is no longer the national pastime, although I tend to disagree. I do realize that football gets higher ratings, but I think more people follow baseball, read about it, listen to it on the radio, understand it, care about it, have played baseball or softball at some point in their lives. So I think baseball is still number one in our hearts. But many years ago, the late great comedian George Carlin did a terrific comedy bit that was comparing baseball to football. And I'd like to share that with you right now. Whoops.
Wrong sheet.
Okay. Baseball is a 19th century pastoral game. Football is a 20th century technological struggle. Baseball's played in a diamond, in a park, the baseball park. Football's played on a gridiron, in a stadium sometimes called Soldier Field or War Memorial Stadium. Football, you wear a helmet. Baseball, you wear a cap. Football is concerned with downs. What down is it? Baseball is concerned with ups. Who's up? Football has clipping, spearing, piling on, personal fouls, late hitting, and unnecessary roughness. Baseball has the sacrifice. In football, you receive a penalty. In baseball, you make an error. Football is played in any kind of weather. Rain, snow, sleet, hail, fog, but in baseball, if it rains, we do not go out to play. Baseball has the seventh inning stretch. Football has the 2-minute warning. Baseball has no time limit. We don't know when it's going to end. We might go extra innings. Football is rigidly timed and will end even if we have to go to sudden death. And finally, the objectives of the two games are completely different. In football, the object is for the quarterback, also known as the field general, to be on target with his aerial assault, riddling the defense by hitting his receivers with deadly accuracy in spite of the blitz, even if he has to use the shotgun. With short bullet passes and long bombs, he marches his troops into enemy territory, balancing this aerial assault with a sustained ground attack that punches holes in the forward wall of the enemy's defensive line. In baseball, the object is to go home and be safe. Okay, we're going to finish up with a couple of songs that you know. Well, let's do the, Brandon, can we do the raffle for the CD? Do you have a name of a person who won?
Yep, the one who was the closest was Susan Burnett Holling with 52, very close.
All right. All right, so the way you, so send Susan my web address, and then if you go to my website, you'll get my email. Send me an email, because I have to email you the tracks. And I will email you the song tracks and the album art. And for those of you who didn't win, you could still go to my website, and you can go to the chat room. Brandon will put it up, and it's very easy. It's howienewman.com. It's howienewman.com. And I have a couple of baseball CDs and a lot of other stuff, too. So
I just sent you a private message, Susan.
Excuse me?
Just telling Susan I sent her a private message with the link and everything.
Okay. This is a song that it's not really a baseball song, but they play it at Fenway Park every single game. I wonder if they still do it. I don't know, because there's nobody in the stand. But it was Neil Diamond's song. I played in the middle of the eighth inning, and the way this happened was about 15 years ago, a Red Sox employee and his wife had a baby girl named Caroline, and so they played Sweet Caroline over the PA system in the eighth inning, and everybody sang along and had a great time with it, and so they tried it the next night, and the same thing happened, and so they've been doing it ever since. So feel free to sing along. You can do this kind of stuff, too, and whatever, and get involved. Thank you. I can't begin to know it, but then I know it's going strong. Wasn't spring, and spring became a summer. Who'd have believed you'd come along? Okay, get your hands up, everybody, hands up. Warm, there you go. Touching warm, reaching out, touching me, touching you. Good time that never seems so good. I've been inclined to believe they never would, but now I look at the night and it don't seem so lonely. We fill it up with only two. And when I hurt, hurt runs off my shoulder. How can I hurt when holding you? Hands up one more time. Warm, touching warm, reaching out, touching me, touching you. Sweet Caroline, good time that never seemed so good. I've been inclined to believe they never would. Sweet Caroline, good time that never seemed so good. I've been inclined to believe they never would. Okay, thank you. All right, I've got one more song, but before I go, and actually, when I finish, we usually do like a little, maybe 3 to 5 minute chit-chat with the audience and, you know, talk to people, and rather than just abruptly ending the show, it's kind of... So if you want to stick around afterwards and just say hello and we could talk a little baseball or whatever, that'd be fine. Or if you got to go somewhere, that's fine too. But I want to thank all you people for showing up this morning. I appreciate it. Thank the Beverly Public Library and Ona and all the people over there. Give them a nice round of applause. They're working very hard to find things, programs that are entertaining and informative and educational, and it's not that easy to do in the middle of a pandemic. So, you know, they deserve a lot of credit, and check the website of the public library and they'll check the calendar there, and they have lots of interesting things to do for people of different ages, different times during the day, and it's really great. And I also want to thank Brandon. He's been my tech for almost all my baseball shows and my other shows, and he does a great job with the photos and making sure everything sounds good and nobody enters the room that's not supposed to be here, you know, so that's cool. So thanks, Brandon, I appreciate it. This is, I think, my 15th baseball show that I've done, and he's been there for most of them. So I'm going to do one final song here, which I think you know, so I want you to unmute yourselves and sing along. This song was written in 1908 by Albert von Tinsler and Jack Norworth. There they are. Neither of whom had ever been to a baseball game prior to writing this song. And they didn't go to a game for like another 20 years. So apparently they weren't terribly convinced about their subject matter, but that's neither here nor there. So just join in. Here we go. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I ever get back in. As a root for the Red Sox. If they don't get some pitching for next year, it'll be a shame. And it's one, two, three strikes, you're out at the old ball little game. All right, we're gonna do it one more time, a little more enthusiasm, okay? I mean, I know the Red Sox are horrible this year, but still fun to watch. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I
never get back.
And it's root for the Red Sox if they don't win. It's a shame. Big finish now. Here we go. For it. Three strikes, you're out at the old ball game. Okay. All right. Give me like about 30 seconds to get into a place where I can sit down. And, okay. All right. All righty. So unmute yourselves, everybody. We have a little discussion. You've been following the base. Anybody been following the Red Sox, or you gave up on them a while ago? I think it's some of the stories are interesting. I think you got Bobby Dalbec hit a lot of home runs, and Tanner Houck pitched yesterday, right? And he's got two good starts. So rather than just wins or losses, there are some interesting things going on. But I guess once the Patriots started. You know, and they have the basketball playoffs and the hockey. But how did you guys find out about the show? Was it through the library? Through the library. They did a good job in promoting that, so that's great. And cool. Have you done a lot of Zoom shows, or is this
yes.
the first? So you like it? You've got the technology down and everything.
Yep.
No. It is different. I'll tell you, it really is different. But. It's the best we have. It's the best and safest thing we can do right now, and there are a lot of advantages to it. You know, it's like, set the stuff up in my living room. You know, and I don't have to go traveling anywhere. But especially for a 9:30 gig, I probably would have had to get up a lot earlier. And like the idea of being able to mute people, because like I used to play in a lot of bars and stuff where people were pretty noisy, so it would have been helpful back then. But so did anybody watch the Patriots last night? You stay up to the very end? Yeah, you got to stay up to the end. It almost went down to the literally went down to the last few seconds. I was kind of a wimp. I watched the first three quarters, and then I watched DVR'd it, and I watched the fourth quarter this morning while I was having breakfast. But I was glad to see you. Anybody have any questions or anything, or? You could have a question of Ona about the library, or any baseball questions, or any Zoom questions, or anything like that. All righty. Well, thanks for coming. Ona, thank you very much for inviting me. It was fun.
And yeah, thank you. Thank you. This went very smootly.
Oh, good. Yes.
Well, yeah, we've done happy to have you. Yeah.
We had fun. We enjoy it. And Susan, you'll get send me an email. I'll get you your.
I'm having trouble connecting to your link, but I'll get it through the website.
If you just...
Yeah, or you can shoot me an email.
Shoot her an email. You can just Google my name, Howie Newman, H-O-W-I-E-N-E-W-M-E, and you'll find it. And,
great. I'll pass
okay,
it
well,
on
thanks. Have a good day. Enjoy the good weather while we have it, and stay safe.
And, yeah. We'll and I hope to see all of you next week and the week after and someday in person.
Check out the calendar. They got some great stuff going on at the library, so... Take care now.
Okay.
Have a good day.
Thank you.
Okay, bye.
And thank Brandon for me too. He was great.
Take care, everybody. See ya.
All right. Bye.